are back talking about the government of Kenya, what decisions it's making and the impact on you as an investor, whether in the fixed income space or in the equity space. Before we took a break, we were just talking about the fact that the macros actually look more or less stable, Eva. Yes. And you're saying the key thing that we need to actually be focusing on is on the rate cap. You do expect a slight adjustment in one way or the other on the rate cap, because that's really the thing that's stifling the economy today. Mm-hmm. But now I want us to just, I want you to help us create a scenario. Okay, fine. Maybe whatever adjustment happens. Today we are looking at a yield curve, which I think our graphics team will be able to put up for us, that has been coming off month on month. What do you expect to happen? Because if today this, the 3 month is at 6.3%, mm-hmm. inflation is at 5%. Before inflation came to 5%, inflation was at 6.3%, so there's no return. Mm-hmm. So what is your outlook on this yield curve, and anybody who's actually putting money in the fixed income space, what are you what are your discussions and considerations in this space?
Yeah, the discussions that we are having, given that the rate cap is the main risk to the yield curve, would be around if the rate cap is removed, again back to the rate cap. So we are keeping our close eye on what's happening in Parliament and also the inflation data.
Okay.
But given that inflation really tends to oscillate between 5% and 6% at the most 7%, then that really does not erode as much value from our fixed income perspective.
Okay.
So the main risk here would be the interest rate cap from a 6 month horizon.
All right.
And in terms of a shorter horizon, then we're looking at the currency depreciation. At what point will the yields start to react?
Okay.
To, and by reacting, I mean an upward trend in the yield curve because of the currency depreciation.
Okay.
So if we start to see foreigners, for example, leaving the infrastructure bonds or selling the infrastructure bonds, then are we going to see a substantial shift higher in the infrastructure bonds because of the currency? So we need to figure out what would be the pain point for
okay.
a foreign investor.
Yes.
But when we also compare what's happening in Kenya to the global markets, then you're looking at negative yields in Europe.
Okay.
And you're looking at the 10-year bond in the U.S. coming off, an inversion of the yield curve there. So where do you really go?
Exactly.
Kenya is offering a stable return. And the curry, which you know would loosely say the coupon rate, is really compensating you
okay.
for
That's
that
true.
Depreciation. That
because you're saying 11.5%, and I mean, possibly the only trigger is if there's an adjustment to the interest rates,
yeah.
or rather the finance bill,
mm-hmm.
but then that adjustment would not make any difference fundamentally. It would really be a more of a perception. Either some
yes.
people would be too excited, some would not be too excited. So that could actually be an opportunity to trade in different asset classes.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
That's, and then I like that you're bringing out the element of global rates, and maybe our team can put up chart number 5. We're looking at the Eurobond and the evolution of that.
Mm-hmm.
The yields on the Kenya 10-year 2024, and this are down to about 5%, 5.2% as of 29th of August.
Mm-hmm.
But this has been coming off from a high of about 6.3% in April. What's
mm-hmm.
really happening there? What's impacting this curve in this way?
Yes, so if you look at the Kenya Eurobonds, and not only Kenya Eurobonds, when you look at sub-Saharan Africa Eurobonds,
okay.
They tend to move in a similar fashion. Unless something happens in the local markets that's quite significant that causes the yield curve to move, the Eurobond yield curve. So in Kenya's case, one of the substantial risk or factors that would have to happen in Kenya for the yield curve to move in a different way to its peers
okay.
would be, say, a removal of the cap or a structural shift in the economy. But so to speak, the factors that really tend to affect the Eurobond performance,
yes.
Kenya Eurobond performance and SSA in general, sub-Saharan Africa, is what's happening in the global markets.
Okay.
So when you look at the trade war, for example, or trade tensions or trade negotiations, depending on what time of the year we're discussing this, when you start to see an abating of the trade tensions, then that tends to support the Eurobond yields.
Okay.
So, for example, when you look at in 2018, late of 2018, when the trade tensions were at their peak,
yes.
The Eurobond yields, particularly the 2024 that we are referring to at the moment,
okay.
were around 8.5%.
Oh, wow.
And now we're seeing
about
5%.
5%.
Yeah, it's
yes.
mainly because throughout 2019, we've seen US and China leave out the last couple of weeks where we saw a blowout, but the US and China coming to the table and trying to figure out, you know, how best do they really discuss the trade negotiations, trade tariffs between the two countries. So in as much as the trade tariff that President Trump had announced earlier on in the year came into effect earlier on in August, came into effect in September. We've seen the credit markets, which the Kenya Eurobond is part of, get more calm compared to where we were in December of 2018.
Wow.
So
wow.
Eurobonds is mainly what's happening in the global market. So we need to have a very good understanding of what's happening in the global markets to trade the Eurobonds.
I like how you brought out that, because what you're telling me is if I'm invested in the Eurobond, then what's happening in the global arena is of more importance to me.
Yes.
Because now I've moved from 8.5 to 5%, and that's in less than 3 months. Actually,
exactly.
Not 3 months, about 6 months.
Yes.
But then when we move to the Kenyan yield curve, there has been it's been coming down. Rates have been coming slightly lower. But then the erosion of returns on the local domestic debt is not as fast as the global.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very important, because for the local market, what is mostly affecting is what's happening internally.
Exactly.
So if I'm in the fixed income, I have two options. If I'm looking internally, I should be more focused on government operations.
Yes.
And liquidity. But if I'm looking externally, my focus has to be global.
Yes.
Okay.
And locally as well, the other factor would be the currency movements.
Currency movements. Mm-hmm. Fantastic. Kenyans are able to invest into the Eurobond, or how do they actually get access to this?
Yes, Kenyans are able to access the Eurobond, but the minimum amount is quite prohibitive.
I'm curious, what is it?
Yeah, it's about 20 million shillings.
20 million, okay.
Yes.
Okay, I'm certainly not in that category. 20 million shillings.
Compared to 50,000 shillings
for the local market.
Yeah,
wow.
And if you're looking at Emma Kiba,
okay,
that's around 3,000 shillings.
That's around 3,000 shillings. So there you have it. Anybody watching, if you don't have 20 million, I don't think you should be asking us about the Eurobond and what's happening. But that's on a light note.
Yes.
Okay, very interesting. There's always the conversation on government debt.
Mm-hmm.
We are at 58% with regards to our outstanding debt, both local and foreign debt, as a percentage of GDP. Of course, everybody is very concerned.
Yes.
But I don't want us to look at how we got here or why it's an issue. My question is 58% okay? Or where do we need to get to so that it becomes a huge problem?
Mm-hmm.
Because, I mean, operations are still ongoing.
Yes.
The taxes are being collected, not as fast as we are expected them to be collected.
Mm-hmm.
Government is still spending. Infrastructure plans are there. The Big Four agenda is there.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, is 58 a number to be worried about? Or are we looking at the wrong parameter here?
Okay. So before we go into the public debt,
okay,
then first I wanted to point out that should you be interested in Eurobonds,
you
never know.
Okay.
Or bonds,
okay.
Standard Chartered would be able to offer you those solutions.
So on one end, I need to come to 20 million if I want to talk to you about Eurobonds.
Yes.
And then on the other end, I need to come to 50,000 and you listen.
Yes, exactly.
Will I speak to you, Eva, if I come with 50,000 or I need the 20 million? On a light note, Eva. Okay, so Standard Chartered actually facilitates these transactions for its clients.
Exactly.
That's very good to know. Thank you
and
for that
access
insight.
Into the Eurobond market.
Okay, and so you can actually go to your bank account, I mean to your branch, or can you call and have this conversation?
Yes, you can call and have the conversation, and also we're also trying to automate some of these services.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah,
I did
digital.
Know that. Oh, we're going digital.
Yes.
Fantastic. So let's move over to the debt, and as you're explaining that, maybe our team can help put up the treasury bills and the treasury bonds so that we can see the percentage split between long and short-term debt.
Okay. So as we wait for that to come up, we're looking at in the local markets, the central bank and the treasury have done a good job in trying to lengthen the maturity profile, which is the length of time it will take before the government will have to refinance some of the maturities that are coming through in the bond market and in the treasury bill market. And understandably, the treasury bills are short term in nature, but when you average it out, when you add the treasury bonds, Kenya has got one of the longest yield curves in Africa.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Is that deliberate?
Yes, it is.
All right, longest yield curve. Okay.
Yes, one of the longest yield curves. So Kenya is in the same bucket as South Africa, which goes all the way to 30 years. And Nigeria more recently has introduced a 30-year this year.
Okay.
So Kenya is, ways ahead compared to its peers in terms of the yield curve. And the government is making steps to make sure that the average maturity profile also is longer.
Okay.
And where some of these steps you may have noticed is the central bank and the national treasury together are now issuing out auctioning bonds that are longer dated.
Yes, we've actually seen that.
Exactly.
Okay, so that's deliberate.
We're looking at 15-year, 20-year bonds that are being issued, and this is mainly to increase the liquidity in that part of the curve, mm-hmm. and also increase the okay. maturity profile.
Interesting. Okay, I think our graphics team will just put up the last chart, and that is chart number 7, because it sounds like the government is trying to manage its debt obligation, exactly. but then on the converse, today 5.8 trillion is the outstanding debt. I think mm-hmm. that's graph number 7 from our graphics team. Should we be concerned?
Yes, so if the public debt to GDP would be in the mid-50s.
Okay.
And in as much as the pace of debt accumulation has been quite fast over, mm-hmm. over a short period of time, we're also cognizant of the fact that there's been several flagship infrastructure projects that have
so
taken place, which has increased the public debt. And it's also come at a time when the yields in the U.S. for the last 10 years, because of quantitative easing, have been quite low. So governments around the world have increased their level of debt.
Yes.
So not just Kenya, particularly foreign debt.
Okay.
Now that, you know, we're still not sure in terms of how the yield curve in the external markets is going to behave.
All right.
Given President Trump and what's happening to the U.S. Fed. But coming back to Kenya, the main question here would be the trajectory of the fiscal deficit as a percentage of GDP.
Okay.
Because the government needs to finance that by borrowing.
Okay.
And so it's this borrowing that's okay. resulting in the public debt increasing. So we need to stabilize the rate at which the public debt is increasing.
Okay.
And by us to be able to stabilize it, we are looking at fiscal deficit numbers that are closer to 4%.
Oh, wow. Okay, fantastic. I think we've come to the end of our show. But then, as we leave, I think you're telling us the opportunities in the fixed income market. What are your parting shots? Where should people put their money? And even as we're looking at the rate cap decision, what are you telling your clients? Fixed income or equities? Just
yes.
briefly.
Yes. No, we like fixed income at the moment because the equity market has not been okay. quite friendly.
Fixed income. Long-term, short-term. What's your best paper?
Yes, so we like infrastructure bonds
infrastructure
because of
bonds.
The tax-free status.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you so much for that overview, and I hope we can have you back soon. It looks like there's a lot to actually consider when we're looking at the government operations and the impact on you as an investor. So there you have it. Really, it feels like the Kenya macro is more or less stable, and we don't actually expect any headwinds or anything material to change, at least in the medium term. I think the thing for us to focus is what happens with the finance bill, especially with regards to the conversation on the rate cap. Any adjustments, which is what Eva expects, and she works as an African strategist at Standard Chartered Bank. She expects a slight adjustment, and this slight adjustment could actually have an impact on the fixed income and on yields as well as on equities. However it goes, it looks like it's actually a good opportunity to keep parking money in some of these asset classes. Thank you for joining us this week. It's been fantastic having you over the last 5 days. We wish you a fantastic weekend and see you again on Monday, same time at 2:30. Good afternoon.